This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The congregation at Duke Chapel is what makes Duke Chapel not just a chapel, but a church. And this morning, the congregation will be holding its activities fair just on the lawn in front of the chapel, or behind the chapel, whichever way you look at it, but certainly the lawn that you reach as you shake my hand and leave gleefully from the chapel each Sunday morning. You'll be able to work out where you belong in the activities of the congregation. If you feel that for you, you want your involvement in Duke Chapel to be not simply about worship, but about other aspects of Christian discipleship, you'll want to pop into the congregation's activities fair and, to use an American expression, check out what's available there just for you. And if you are teetering on the brink of thinking, I might go or I might not go, I'll tell you what'll clinch it for you. Due to popular demand, we have extended our offering of Loco Pops for one more week. And this time, rather more like God, we are not going to discriminate between students and others. It's first come, first served, but you can't find them unless you enter the congregation activities fair. So that should swing it for you. Today is a very special Sunday each year in the life of Duke Chapel when we bless our new Pathways Fellows who are living in the house in the West End in Chapel Hill Street. It's a special Sunday because the different parts of Duke Chapel's life come together. The worshipping life, the musical life, but also the life of mission and the life of ministry, and particularly the growing faith and vocation of students all to come together as we dedicate this new house full of new alums as members of the Pathways House this morning. Let's stand and worship God.
We were created to enjoy God forever. Let us name before God the ways our lives have fallen short of his glory. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may lighten our will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ, our Lord. May our neighbors see the joy in our eyes as we recognize before them that we are forgiven sinners and forgive them at the same time. Let's share words of peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord God, defend your church from all false teaching, and give to your people knowledge of your truth, that we may enjoy eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Exodus, the 32nd chapter. The Reverend Jones will be preaching from this text. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshiped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.' The Lord said to Moses, 'I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone, so that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them. And of you, I will make a great nation.' But Moses implored the Lord his God and said, 'O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt, with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have promised I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he planned to bring on his people." This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from 1 Timothy, the first chapter. "I am grateful to Christ Jesus our Lord, who has strengthened me, because he judged me faithful and appointed me to his service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and a man of violence. But I received mercy because I had acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the foremost. But for that very reason, I received mercy so that in me, as the foremost, Jesus Christ might display the utmost patience, making me an example to those who would come to believe in him for eternal life. To the King of the ages, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from Luke, the 15th chapter. Now all the tax collectors and sinners were coming near to listen to Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes were grumbling and saying, "This fellow welcomes sinners and eats with them." So he told them this parable. Which one of you, having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, "Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost." Just so, I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous people who need no repentance. Or what woman having 10 coins, if she loses one of them, does not light a lamp, sweep the house, and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so, I tell you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. seated. God, guide me and let the words from my mouth be acceptable in thy sight. Let the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Amen. When Israel was in Egypt's land, let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand, let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. No more in bondage shall they toil. Let my people go. Let them come out with Egypt's spoil. Let my people go. Go down, Moses, way down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. This song speaks of freedom and of struggle. It reminds me of the struggle of my own people and inspires me to live a life of freedom for which they longed. It ought to remind us all of the people who have struggled and are enslaved everywhere, of the hope for freedom and the God that desires freedom for his people. God said, "Let my people go," and it was so. But please believe that this is the expedited version. This journey to freedom was not as simple as one might think or might have even hoped. It was not without death, without pain, and without struggle. You see, when people are in bondage, the one who has them bound is never so eagerly willing to set them free. Pharaoh in this case was no different than the others. It was not until the death of his firstborn son that he finally set the Israelites free. And they've been set free only to find themselves in a wilderness, having done so much and gone through so many trials to gain freedom. This was the last thing they expected. I wonder if this is a 35-year-old story, or maybe one of present day. We call Duke a beautiful Gothic wonderland, but for many it's a Gothic wilderness. For me, it was not much different. Not long ago, I came to this Gothic wonderland. Yes, I know I can easily pass for an undergrad or maybe a grad student, but I came to Duke as an undergraduate many years ago, graduating in 2005. An honor and yet quite daunting. I would lie if I said to you that I do not come with some apprehension and a bit of trepidation. Not much different from the sentiment of many a freshman. This wonderland that I had sought so eagerly and intently had become a wilderness. I faced difficulties I had not foreseen and obstacles I was not too excited to find. Here I found myself at Duke, a seemingly perfect place. But I soon started to feel lonely, as though I had no shelter. It was a completely new terrain, unlike anything I had ever encountered. Realizing I had no family, and it seemed nothing I knew was here, I began to doubt myself. Maybe I had made the wrong choice. What if I wasn't supposed to be here? Maybe I should just go back to what I know. You know, I was in a wilderness. Maybe you too have gained newfound freedom, only to find yourself in the midst of a wilderness experience. Perhaps your wilderness is being far away from home, away from what you know, your mother, your father, your sisters, and your brothers. Perhaps your wilderness is managing this unknown terrain of Duke University. Where's Friedel? And how in the world do I get to Research Drive? I don't know how I'm going to get all of this work done and still have a life. Or your self-created wilderness is the loneliness in which you find yourself despite surrounding yourself with people you'd like to call friend. You think to yourself, these aren't my real friends. They don't even know me, and I don't really know them. Where is your comfort? You are still in the midst of a wilderness. And perhaps the most pervasive, yet difficult to identify, is self-hate. This one is a wilderness that touches people of all nationalities, colors, races, religions, and ideologies. The thought that you are just not good enough. Every few minutes, the words out of your mouth, you wouldn't be so bold as to say them out loud. The words echoed in your head are, you're just not good enough. Who wants you anyway? You'll never be so-and-so. You're ugly, you're fat. You fill in the blank. It is none other than self-hate. Let's take it a level deeper. Perhaps your wilderness experience brought you to such pain that you even contemplated your own death. Let's be real, this is not something to play with. The miry pits in which people sink in self-shaped wildernesses is beyond anyone's imagination. And further still, the depths to which we will seek to find a place of solace in the midst of the wilderness is beyond recognition. At this juncture, the Israelites find themselves seeking solace in a wilderness without Moses. Their response is to gather around Aaron. Oh, that just sounds just a little bit too PC for me. I doubt that they gathered around Aaron. No doubt these people had grown restless of their wilderness, the situation in which they found themselves. They cornered Aaron and demanded, no, forced him into doing as they pleased. Come, make a God for us who shall go before us. As for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. You see, the Israelites said, we need someone to go before us, who will be here with us, who will be our advocate. We don't know what has become of this Moses, who was supposed to carry us to the promised land. Feeling perhaps abandoned, afraid, disconcerted, or just plain fearful, the people decided that they needed an object, something physical, something they could touch and see and feel to go before them. What a marked contrast from the humility and reverence displayed just days before as they offered sacrifice and made a promise to the only one true living God of Israel. Within little over 30 days, this people had gone against God and completely disregarded his words and the promise they made. Only days ago, God had spoken saying, I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them. That's some pretty tough language coming from God. You see, God is serious about this thing. It's not a game. God meant exactly what God said. Yet these newly freed people gathered together their golden earrings and crafted a golden calf, or better stated, a golden ox or bull, in a matter of days. They had given of their treasures to construct a false idol. They had forged for themselves a god. Not just any god, but Apis, the chief god of Egypt. How amazing. These freed people had taken the god of their Egyptian oppressors as their own. While they had escaped oppression corporally, they had not managed to do so mentally. While they had escaped through the land of Egypt, they still carried with them souvenirs of their oppressor. Believing this golden idol would be the strength and power they lacked, especially without Moses, they fashioned for themselves what God abhorred most. You see, 40 days and 40 nights is quite a long time to go without one's leader. And of course, they needed one to go before them. Yes, a molten god. How could they do such a thing, you say? Do they not know the great pains through which God went to set them free? But let us not be so hasty in jumping at these people, for we too are guilty of this very thing. No. Me? No, you? Of course not. How, you ask? We are bound by minds seeking to develop gods of our own in one shape or another. No, it may not be in the shape of a golden ox, but it may be in the form of bodily gratification. Maybe it's sex, pornography, cutting, or gluttony. Perhaps it's addiction to alcohol, prescription drugs, meth, weed. I mean, you name it, someone's taking it. Believing that these empty gods, for their fleeting moments of pleasure, can take you out of your wilderness, you flee to their comfort. Oh, but then you come back to reality and find you're still in the wilderness with an empty god. Your god may not be something readily seen as wrong. Perhaps your golden god is that you place your faith on your education. Yes, you have spurned your life's wages, riches, and glory on an education here at Duke or some other institution named, I will not say, down the road, with the belief that it will go before you and lead you to riches and glory. Or perhaps you build your faith on your beauty and elegance. Yes, with the thought that your clothes, your makeup, your hair, your smile will open doors for you and go before you. But perhaps your hope is built in the thought that your riches will go before you. You have built for yourself such a nest egg, such a corporation of thousands and even millions of dollars, that has become your god, your idol. But perhaps it's not even an idea, but perhaps it's a person. Perhaps it's a literal idol to whom you look up to and believe will be able to uphold and upkeep you, to go before you as Moses did before the Israelites. Perhaps this person is your pastor, yes, one on earth that will go before you and clear the way for your journey, one to speak to God on your behalf, or perhaps you think protect you in the midst of trial. Can I push it? Or perhaps this human is not even an actual person, but the dream of one sent from heaven to come up and save you like Prince Charming. This is the man you've waited all your life for, and hope will save you from this loneliness of life without a companion. That's exactly it. Please trust, I have not been without my own dreams and hopes for Prince Charming, galloping in, not on a golden ox, but on a golden horse. But this is merely a good-looking god. Yes, looking seems to be, but is not. Now, please realize that some of these ideals are not such horrible ideas, but nonetheless, they are idols manifested in the minds of a freed people. Why would a freed people seek bondage once again in whatever form it might be? I dare say, fear that the one who set them free could not keep them free. And perhaps at fault was the claim that Moses was the one to set the people free. As they claimed, as for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. And who knows how long this was their belief, but Moses was not their savior. It was not he who set the captives free. He was not just any god, but it was the Lord thy God which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Yahweh, yes, Jehovah, the Lord who set every Christian free when he came down to earth in bodily form, a tangible sign of his presence. If you need a corporal image of God, look to Christ. Jesus is the eternal response to Israel's golden calf, the God of mercy and compassion, of loving kindness that came down from glory. Emmanuel, God with us. If you need to look to a God, look to the one who put on human flesh to take on the sin that so easily besets us. Jesus, our advocate, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the author and finisher of our faith, the chief cornerstone, deliverer, high priest, the Holy One, King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the Lamb of God, the Lion of Judah, Master, the bright and morning star. Our protection, our righteousness, our Redeemer. He is the Son of the living God, and whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Live life free, free indeed. Amen.
As Dean Wells mentioned in his greeting this morning, this is indeed a special day for us as we commission and bless our 2010-2011 Duke Chapel Pathways Fellows. Milton Gilder, Charisma Nelson, Injun Grace Jew, and Jesse Huddleston moved in to the Pathways House in August and immediately began setting about the very hard but joyful work of becoming a Christian community. They are doing this through daily morning prayer, 25-hour-a-week work week, attendance and enrollment in Duke Dean Wells' public policy course, considering various ways to serve in our community, regular meals together. We rejoice with them as they start this 10-month experience together, living out their Christian faith. The Pathways House began in the fall of 2006, and it is flourishing today because of the loving and committed friendships and partnerships that we have found in the West End and our West End neighbors, as well as the leadership and support of our colleagues in the Department of Community Affairs here at Duke University, our placement partners, and several members of this, our own Duke congregation. In a moment, we will invite a few of them up as the representatives of those groups, where Dean Wells will offer a prayer and a blessing for them also. At this time, I take great pleasure in leading our Duke Chapel Pathways Fellows in their official commissioning. As Duke Chapel Pathways Fellows, all of you have made a year-long commitment to explore vocation through communal life in the West End. Together, you have committed to a year of vocational exploration through engagement in nonprofit and ministry settings in Durham. Milton, Jesse, Grace, Charisma, is this your understanding of the role to which you have been called? It is. Amen. May the Lord indeed bless you with courage, faith, and mutual forbearance as you seek to know God and make him known. And the people said, amen.
At Duke Chapel, we celebrate those in the Durham community who long for reconciliation and social healing. Here today are many who care deeply about the West End and surrounding neighborhoods, and many who are allowing their lives to be gently transformed by new friendships. Today, we renew our commitment to journey together. Do you believe God is at work in the West End? Loving God, give us grace to meet you in one another and teach us to walk in your footsteps day by day. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Liberating God, you have the power to free us from every enslavement. Break the chains of those who feel bound by hopelessness and despair. Give us the strength to remain faithful to your commandments and resist the temptation to make idols of things such as wealth, power, prestige, youth, beauty, and knowledge. We pray for our political leaders that you will use them and us to stop the cycles that cause poverty, that perpetuate injustice, and that sanction violence. As our Muslim sisters celebrate Eid al-Fitr, the end of Ramadan, and our Jewish brothers mark the start of a new year, this Rosh Hashanah, we implore you to bring your spirit of peace to situations of religious conflict. Quell the tides of intolerance that surround us and guide new efforts for a just and lasting peace in the Middle East. We pray for spiritual leaders that they will be a prophetic voice in the face of public discord and will model for us all how to live a life with you that is free indeed. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful God, your Son Jesus came into the world to save sinners, and we all benefit from your grace. Appoint us to your service, as you did with your Apostle Paul. In a moment of silence, we remember all who struggle to find meaningful ways of serving you. Turn our ignorance into love and our unbelief into faith. Make us patient. Teach us kindness. Replace brokenness with reconciliation and suffering with healing. Lord, in your mercy. Searching God, like the shepherd separated from his flock, who lays the lost sheep across his shoulders and rejoices at finding it, you search us out and bring us home. When we feel abandoned, afraid, and lost, give us the joy of feeling your presence with us. Be a voice in the wilderness, calling us out of our wanderings, and let us hear the rejoicing in heaven that comes in reunion with you. Encourage us to seek out the lonely and the displaced, the homeless in Durham and around the world, and families impacted by natural disaster. Pakistanis who long for the comforts of home in the midst of mud and flood. New Zealanders affected by earthquakes, and Coloradans dealing with the devastation of forest fires. We lift up to you Durham's West End, the children, families, elderly, and individuals such as our Pathways Fellows who live and work there, and all those in our city who need a companion in life's journey. Transform our lives through strengthened friendships. Reveal your face through neighbors and community. Let all whom we encounter consider us to be a blessing, so that by our presence, others may experience your love. Lord, in your mercy. God of our ancestors, you promised Moses descendants like the stars of heaven. Find us worthy to be counted among your children and hear us as we join our voices with all others who've worshiped you and praise your holy name. Amen. And now, with grateful hearts, let us offer our gifts to God through this week's offering.
If you are here today with a person or an issue weighing heavy on your heart, ministers will be in the memorial chapel to my right during the serving of communion, and they will be happy to pray with you. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Shepherding God, we give you thanks and praise because you called Abraham and Isaac and Israel to be your own possession. And when Israel wandered away from your sheepfold into the wilderness, you searched high and low and in Jesus came among your people to bring them home to you. Just so when we wander away, you come to us in Jesus and place us on your shoulders and bring us home, to join your angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, rejoicing over every sinner that repents and singing the hymn of your unending praise. God of grace, you spread a table in our sight and invite us to join you in glory. Now send down your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, who at supper with his disciples took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread and gave it to him, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. Again, he gave you thanks and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Passionate God, in your words to Moses, we see how much our idolatry grieves you and enslaves us. But in Moses' prayer, we discover how much our prayers mean to you and how deeply you long to set us free. Cleanse our anger with your anger. Dismantle our idolatry with your simplicity. And visit your oppressed people who live under the idolatrous domination of others, that we and all your people may burn with the fire of your love and shine with the light of your Spirit to make known the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, ever one God, world without end. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. In the broken body of Christ, we find our peace with God. God sets a table in our sight, and oh, what transport of delight from his pure chalice floweth.
Thank you.
Merciful God, we give you thanks that morning by morning new mercies we see. We thank you for the Department of History at this university, for the ways it seeks to tell a truthful story of our past, derive wisdom for the present, and uphold suppressed and forgotten voices to be heard anew. Bless the recipients of today's offering, and all in our city who struggle under burdens too great to bear alone. God only wise, you delight to make your people out of food, and the food out of which you make us is your body and blood. As we have become your body in the eating of food, bless those with whom we share food this week, and bless those with whom we share you and in whom we meet you, that in being made your body, we may become food for your world. And through the change they see in us, all may come to praise the glories of your name. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.